let my slide come on. I think I am really like humbled to be here because like we have got a number of you from Japan, from South Korea, from Indonesia, from Malaysia, and of course from Thailand, right? That have actually done so much in MOOCs. So I am quite humbled as in I would more be a user of MOOC rather than be a policy person in MOOCs. But I reckon I've got to try to give an excuse why I'm being invited here, right? Because it's really obvious why the rest of you are here to give a talk, right? But it is less clear why I'm here, right? Because I think like the majority of you, you have been involved in like MOOCs for the last 4 to 5 years. As compared to me, I think the only MOOCs that I've run is with the Institute of Education London, like using Coursera, where we use it as a knowledge transfer type of course of a 3-year project that we are working with the UNESCO Institute in Moscow. Right, the ICT in education, the UNESCO Institute in Moscow, whereby we try to use that as a knowledge transfer platform, right, to disseminate our ICT in primary schools research that we have done internationally to teachers, to policymakers, to school leaders from all over the world. So I would say that that is my key experience in MOOCs, right? So as I've said, I'm really humbled. So the excuse why I am here, okay, so that you would listen to what I've got to say and share. I think I've always been involved with respect to the policy level, not just working with UNESCO, but the Asian Development Bank, the World Bank, the Inter-American Development Bank, working with the different governments. So, for example, in the Indonesia, I was working on a ICT and education master plan for rural and remote Indonesia, as well as in Papua, right? So I came up with the ICT and master plan in Papua. In the Bangladesh, I have been working on the national education plan as well, right? So so I'm just trying to justify that, hey, you know, it's like, although I may not know a lot about MOOCs, but I just hope that my experiences working with policymakers at the national level and with international organizations would contribute to this conversation, right? So, which is what I'm going to be working through with you. I think you have got to start my slide because I do not know what to say without my slide, actually. Yeah. Oh, I can start the slide myself, I forgot. Okay, massive open online courses, questions, issues, and policy implications. So I will be leading you right through from the questions that we may ask. I have tapped upon quite a lot of your keynotes talk like today. I was not here yesterday because I was working with the Nanyang Technological University yesterday in Singapore. So I would be tapping a lot on the different slides that were presented today. And then after that, I would move on to the issues and eventually, based on the questions and issues, what are some of the policy implications at the national level that you may want to consider? Okay, because this is a UNESCO-sponsored event or a UNESCO-led event, I think we probably need to go back to the vision of Education 2030, right? Which is the Incheon Declaration that draws upon the Sustainable Development Goal, right? So if we align, if the starting point of this conversation is Education 2030, right, which states that inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. Right, so we are really talking about the access to quality education, which is equity, right? quality as well as efficiency. And I think when we are looking at MOOCs, you are looking at it from the efficiency point of view, as in external efficiency. How is what we are doing in our courses relevant, right, to the real, right, that would improve the employability of a person or of a citizen within our country or in other countries? And of course, if we look at the SDG 4, the Education 2030, it's quite clear that the lifelong learning is one of the key one, right? The ability to learn for life, right? And of course, if we compare the SDG, right, to the MDGs, right? I think the MDGs focus a lot on access, but now we are really interested in quality access, right? So if I may, what we are really looking at is the issue of equity, quality, and efficiency, right? And those are actually the challenges that all society faces, may it be the global north or global south. Of course, in the global south, the issue is more pertinent, right, where we have a rural-urban divide, right? But the thing is, even in the global north, there is also the have-nots, right? Which means that there is always the issue of equity. And I think if you look at a lot of the East Asian economies, right, like, say, in Hong Kong. Okay, by the way, I'm based in Hong Kong, but I'm not a Hong Kong Chinese. From my accent, you can tell that I am a Singaporean Chinese, right? So I'm a Singaporean Chinese, but still a Chinese, but Singaporean Chinese, yeah? Okay, so we are talking about the East Asia. So see, even if you are looking at the East Asian context, right, whereby there is a huge focus on examinations, high-stake public examinations, I think we always have that challenge of external efficiency in terms of, are we preparing our students to be able to learn how to learn? Which, if we are going to align to the SDG 4 or Education 2030, there is really quite a big issue and quite a big gap there. Right, so as like what I'm trying to say, the issues of equity, quality, and efficiency is not just an issue in the global south, although a lot of conversations take place in the global south about these three issues, but in the global north as well, these are issues that we really need to take note of. Just to give you some basic definition, like what a good professor would do, right? To give you the definitions of terms. Okay, when we look at quality, it is really a lot about meeting needs of the students, being able to engage and improve students' learning outcomes or the learning outcomes, right, of a particular course. If you are talking about MOOCs, you are talking about achieving the outcomes of the MOOCs, if not the outcomes of the person who is undergoing the MOOCs or the SPOCs, right? As what like Professor Im said. Okay, Im and Lim is quite close, so you know, it's like, I would quote a lot from Professor Im, right, because I'm a Lim, right, so I extend an Im. Okay, it's really corny, but you got to make really corny jokes after lunch, right? It's quite tough, you know, it's like, I'm not a corny person, but you know, it's like if it's after lunch, I just pretend to make you laugh and smile. Yeah. Okay. So that would be the quality, and of course, for the equity, it's quite clear. It's not just about access, right? It's about completion, achievement, transition, survival, etc. So it is beyond access, and I think for efficiency, as what I've said, we are not just looking at external efficiency, whether we are producing outcomes, right, that is able to meet the needs of the society. So, of course, when we are looking at higher education institutions, when we are looking at learning organizations, right, it's all about or a key part of it is really about being well aligned to the 21st century competencies, right? And one of these key competencies is lifelong learning, yeah? Okay, so what then does MOOCs afford equity, quality, and equity, right? So I would just like run through with you which over the last 2 days you have already been talking through the affordances. Okay, the affordances, like meaning the opportunities provided by MOOCs, right? In order to address issues of equity, quality, and efficiency, right? So we know that it is massive, it is open, right? It is online, and it is a course, which means that there's a structure around a set of learning goals in a defined area of study. Okay, of course, if you look at this definition, this is just one of the many definitions. But the reason why I draw upon this definition is I want to emphasize how this definition, right, relates back to the issue of equity, quality, and efficiency, right? Because if it's massive, it's open, then we do hope that it will be able to address the equity issue, right? If it is able to allow the learners to work through at their own pace and to identify their own learning gaps, right? As what Professor Im said again, you know, it's like, it's really like, right, it's really about just-in-time learning, right? To be able to not just like reflect upon what you have learned, but also plan your own learning trajectory of where you want to go, right? In terms of what you need to learn, right? Which MOOCs actually play a really big role, right? So the efficiency issue is there, the quality issue is there, and of course, because it's massive and open, you address the equity issue as well. But of course, like this would probably be research that those of you doing MOOCs are quite familiar with, issues that again, it does not apply to all MOOCs, it does not apply to all situations, but it is common situations that actually, or is common issues that actually arise from MOOCs. Think based on some of the research that have been done, you know, it's like the majority of MOOCs participants usually, okay, not that they have nothing better to do in their life, right? But the thing is, they can afford that, they can afford the time, right? And quite often they are educated, and they are either doing a postgraduate, and they are usually already employed, right? Which actually leads us to the second point. Although you are increasingly seeing MOOCs from different like languages, but still quite a lot of MOOCs are in English. But language to one side, right? There is still a big emphasis on the basic literacy skills. Means you need to have the basic literacy competencies. I'm not even talking about digital literacy yet, right? Basic literacy in terms of reading, writing, listening, right? As well as speaking, right? What we are like trying to say here is at times, like certain people might be marginalized, right? From access to MOOCs because they might lack that basic competencies. Not necessarily in English, it might be a Korean MOOCs in Korea, right? But if we want to be able to target a particular group, right? Are we really targeting that group if that group do not have that basic competencies? And if we look at MOOCs, like for those of you who have been really involved, you would agree with me that MOOCs assume a lot about the students, right? They assume that students know how to learn online, which means that they are able to pace their own learning, they are able to reflect upon what they have learned, right? They are able to take stock, which means that we are really expecting students being able to monitor and manage their own learning process, which is what student-centered learning is about, which is what basically every education system and every learning society is striving towards, right? That we want our citizens, we want our learners to always be able to manage and monitor their own learning, right? Unlike in the school system, right? If you look at K-12, okay, like kindergarten to primary school, quite often a lot of that is being taken over by the teachers. And even in the university, the undergraduates, when they go to your university, they expect you to be the ones that monitor and manage their own learning, or the students' learning, rather than them managing it themselves, which means that they do not take responsibility of their own learning process, which is quite an issue, because that would mean that if the learners are expected to go into MOOCs, would they be able to learn online by themselves? And if they are we again marginalizing people who do not have that competencies? So, which means, what type of support should we be providing? Okay, so if education 2030 is the vision, okay, if we see that as may we be from global north or global south, right, east, south, or Southeast Asia, right? We do agree that equity, quality, and efficiency are big education challenges, right? And we want to address that challenge, right? If that is the vision, how do MOOCs align themselves to this vision? So I have came out with some questions. Some of it have been raised, right? And I think these are questions that is not just to be considered at the national policy level, right? It's also questions that universities and institutions need to be asking themselves as well, right? We have heard about the purpose of MOOCs. So what is and what are the purpose of MOOCs? What are we attempting to address, right? Are we attempting to just, you know, pick up the next latest collection, right? May it be Prada, Gucci, Ferragamo, right? Or are we trying to actually address some education issues with MOOCs? So what exactly is the purpose of MOOCs, or are the purposes of MOOCs, right? Think the next question that has been raised: who are the target audience? Who are we reaching out to, right? And like, for those that we are reaching out to, when we are reaching out to them, what issues are we really trying to address? Why are MOOCs chosen as the preferred ICT enabled learning? Is it because it's massive, it's open, that's why we are choosing it? Because is it because it's the fashion, right? Because like the Ute in Indonesia is actually adopting MOOCs, and therefore the other universities in Indonesia should adopt MOOCs as well, right? Is that it, right? So think, we need to think through that. How are MOOCs designed, developed, and implemented to meet the purposes of? I think that is quite key. I think there are a lot of policy implications with regards to design development as well as implementation, that at the policy level, more could be done, right? And of course, the part that is always left out is the evaluation. And we're not just looking at impact evaluation in terms of the summative evaluation. We are also looking at formative ongoing evaluation. As you are carrying out the MOOCs, the feedback from what you get from the MOOCs through learning analytics or through very informal feedback from the students, how are you going to act upon it in order to revise the learning and teaching activities within the MOOC itself? Okay, Professor Im again. Okay, I do not know why I quoted him. Yeah, but as I say, I got this like affinity to the Yim and Lim thing, right? So I just want to extend some of the stuff that he was talking about. The purpose of MOOCs, I think he came up with a survey which was done about 3 or 4 years ago, right, about what the purposes of MOOCs are, extending reach and access, a lot to do with equity, right? To build and maintain brand, branding, quality, equity, efficiency, maybe cost effectiveness, improving economics, again, the economies of scale, the internal efficiency. It is an innovation. It might be linked to branding as well, but it might be linked to wanting to improve the quality of learning and teaching, right? And of course, MOOCs allow you to deal with massive data because it's massive, right? And it is online, which means that you are able to gather a lot of data, right? Which means that you are able to you're able to research upon what type of activities engages the student, right? What type of activities are able to target certain set of competencies that we want to be developing. Okay, so I extended Im to Lim. So this is my slide. Copyright, yeah? Okay, so I should have put like Professor Lim there, right? You know, yeah. Okay, so if you take a look at this, not much differences, but it's an extension and a bit more real because it... I'm not that sophisticated in my language, right? So the first one is a lot to do with branding, which a lot of top universities are doing, right? To brand your product, to showcase our best courses, right? So in Hong Kong, okay, in the University of Hong Kong, not the Education University of Hong Kong, the much older and okay, I wouldn't say much better, but more comprehensive, better comprehensive university. We are an education university, so different. You can't compare apple and pear, yeah? Right, you could see them actually dedicating a lot of resources just to be able to showcase 9 to 10 courses. Really resource intensive. Providing access to quality education beyond the university, right? Really trying to address equity issue, which is actually linked to the next one. How do you deal with, how do you provide the support for the marginalized members of the community, right? So what we are doing in like Hong Kong, or at least in my university, by the end of the year, we would be working with our students in terms of some of their general education courses to create, not really MOOCs, it might be called SPOCs, but it's okay, it's still a MOOC for Indonesian domestic workers in Hong Kong. Okay, because what you have got to know that in Hong Kong, small country, okay, it's not even a country, right? Small region, okay, 9 million people, but we have got more than 300,000 domestic workers, right? But yet, when those people come to us, they have a huge contribution to the Hong Kong economy. Huge contribution. Huge contribution because they allow both papa and mama, father and mother, to go into the workforce, right? To contribute to the economy of Hong Kong, right? And they would be in the household, taking care of the kids as well as the house. Right, huge impact. But the thing is, what then are we doing to them or doing for them? Right? Are we providing them with a set of competencies that after 4 years in Hong Kong, 8 years in Hong Kong, when they go back to Indonesia, that they are able to go back with a set of competencies that would then contribute to the economy of Hong Kong, not just financially, right, but in terms of productivity, right? So like some of the courses that we are thinking of running includes things like microfinance, the microfinance management, the setting up of small businesses, right? And it also includes some of the courses about speaking the Hong Kong language, which is not Mandarin, it's not Putonghua, it is Cantonese, which I can't speak because I'm not from Hong Kong, yeah? But I think we really need to be clear. Okay, of course there would be multiple purposes, but we need to embrace that. If it is multi-purposes, then I think the policy need to be upfront that this is what we are trying to embrace. Engaging the community in the context of learning for life. So again, if you look at a lot of countries, especially advanced countries, right, you could see that industries are changing, right? And quite often, a person who have been employed in a company for 20 years may be made redundant, right? So again, there need to be this whole notion of learning for life, which means that as they are being taken out of one job, that they can learn to take up another job within a 6 months period or 1 year period, which means that we are able to address structural unemployment, right? And it becomes like frictional unemployment, very short term, right? Not due to, yes, there's a change in structure, but the citizens in the country are responsive enough, right, to be able to take up the learning opportunities and to pick up a set of new skills that would make them relevant to another job or another industry. Provide opportunities for students from other universities to learn in an area which their universities do not have expertise in. I think if you look at the Malaysian case, right, that is what the Malaysian government is trying to do, right? To be able to provide opportunities for students from one university that might be interested in specialization, but not provided in their university, but yet able to obtain credit from that university. Right, so yes, it started out small, but now I think it is including a lot of, or the majority of the public funded university in Malaysia, right? So we need to take note that that is one possibility. And of course, engaging in knowledge transfer, I would reckon that the universities, the appraisers in the university, especially in the global north, a lot of emphasis on research in terms of the grants that you bring back, in terms of the papers that you write. But how would that impact the community? So again, could MOOCs provide a way to engage the community with research findings? I got 5 minutes left. Okay, I think I should stop like quoting Professor Im. You know, it's like it's just taking up too much of my time. Yeah, you know, it's like all that. My talk was just supposed to be 30 minutes, but because I quoted him, now it's going to be like 1 hour. Yeah, it's too much, man. Okay, target audience. I think like he have identified general MOOC learners, paid MOOCs, MOOC learners, Spock learners, come and go, and flip learners in the context of a blended learning environment. Yeah, I came up with some as well. So just as an extension, right? We are talking about potential students and partners, disadvantaged marginalized groups, general public, students from other universities, students from within the university, professional communities, and academic and teaching staff from other universities. Right, so just to relate this back to what Professor Im have been talking about just now about target audience. We need to be really clear who our target audience are, even if we are dealing things from the national level. Okay, in terms of design, development, implementation of MOOCs, I think there's a lot to be done with regards to needs and situation analysis. So if we are going to be targeting one group, do they have access to network technologies? Do they have access to hardware? What type of hardware are they using? Right, so as what I've shared, the MOOC project that we are running in Hong Kong by the end of the year, we are starting out to do a lot of the questionnaire, survey, and interview of the domestic workers in Hong Kong, right, with regards to what type of mobile phones are they using, what type of data plan are they signing up to, are they using wireless network within the household, or are they using something else, just to get a sense, right? The design, target audience, expected outcomes, I think that is really crucial. What type of teaching and learning activities? The development, I think, a lot to do with resources. But the key thing about the development, I think two things come out really strongly. One is with respect to scaffolds. I think as teachers in a classroom, we know what scaffolding is, right? You provide students with help, with guidance in order to meet a particular outcome. But I think at times in the online environment, we need to know that a lot of the scaffolds are actually fixed scaffolds. What type of guidelines, guiding questions, templates are we going to be providing the students, right? And of course, what we have got to know too is we need to understand that assessment drive practices, right? Students might not want to engage if assessment task is different from the teaching and learning task, which means that there must be that alignment between teaching, learning, and assessment, which makes the design and development of assessment tasks really crucial. And of course, the implementation, publicity and enrollment, access to necessary infrastructure, access to learning support. And of course, the last one would be evaluation, something that we should be taking a bit more seriously, not just in terms of the quality enhancement processes of our courses, but also to be able to provide evidences to policymakers, right, as well as the general public. So what is and what are the impacts of MOOCs, right, for a particular purpose, right, to evaluate the impact with respect to equity, quality, and efficiency. So what do you mean by quality, right? So are we going to be measuring quality by the outcomes, right? What do you mean by the equity? So do we look at the number of people who are accessing, right, your particular MOOCs itself? And then you develop instruments, so you develop data collection instruments, right, in order to measure and determine the impact. You got to be able to complete the feedback loop. As what I said, it's not just about summative evaluation, it's also about formative evaluation, right? And of course, to inform future practices and policy formulation. I think that is really important because we talk a lot about evidence-based policies, right? We want our policies makers, may it be in Hong Kong, in Indonesia, in Japan, or in Korea, to understand, right, more about what we are doing, right, and to be able to convince them to be able to formulate some policy that is better, or which will better drive and support MOOCs in the country itself. Issues and challenges, I listed out quite a number. Wes, do you think I can have like 10 more minutes? Yeah. No, I just get carried away. Yeah. And you know, it's like blame Professor Im, you know, it's like he put thoughts in my mind. Like before I heard his talk, I just got 3 slides. Look at how many slides I've got now. Disgusting, right? Yeah. So, you know, it's like, don't blame me. Okay, I'll try to go through it fast. Okay, issues and challenges. I think there's a lack of clear vision at the system level about what MOOCs are, right, and what MOOCs are for. I think there's a lot more that we could do as a MOOC community. The labor intensiveness of MOOCs, as what I was sharing with you in the Hong Kong University MOOCs, like some of the MOOCs over a period of a 10 session course actually have 9 teaching assistants. So again, you know, it's like, yes, you know, it's a fantastic MOOC, right? The impact is there, but it's so labor intensive, which means that there are issues with cost effectiveness, right? And could we scale that up? I think that is always the question. 9 MOOCs out of 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 course is easy, piece of cake. But what if we increase that to 20, 30 MOOCs, right? The lack of scale, as what I've said, you know, it's like quite often what you see is like 1 or 2 courses per faculty. Of course, in the JMOOC, I could see that in some of the faculties you have more, but some you have very little as well. So again, how could we scale that? How could we sustain it? Like the MOOC that I ran with Institute of Education London under Coursera, the first run we have got about 8,000, the second run, I think a lot of the instructors, they lost steam, right? And we only have about 2,000 or so. And now we have moved the MOOC to on demand, right? And the number have actually gone down quite substantially, right? So is there sustainability? Lack of access for the learners to internet connection, hardware and resources, I've spoken about that before. Lack of capacity of learners to learn online, a big thing, right? Lack of capacity of academic to design assessment tasks. Think when we think about MOOCs sometimes, we think a lot about multimedia development, we think a lot about the design of the learning task, but I think we don't think enough of the assessment task. How can we ensure that the assessment task is meaningful, is authentic, so that the learners would want to engage in it, right? And of course, the lack of engagement of key stakeholders. This is in the book that both like Dr. Wang Liping and I had, which we pass it around, or rather we force the book upon you, right? So you better bring home. I do not want to see the book lying in your room, okay? I'll ask the housekeeping to do a check, right? And I'll take note of your room number, and I'll take note of your name, okay? Because that's what I tend to do sometimes. Like, people give you a conference pack, and you just leave the conference pack in your room. Okay, definitely not with Thai Cyber University, but other conferences, yeah? Okay, so if you take a look at this, we came up with this framework that is more geared towards blended learning. But if you look at the dimensions, I think quite a lot of the dimensions up there is actually applicable, right, as we are thinking through MOOCs itself, right? Vision, curriculum, including assessment, PD, learning support, infrastructure, policy and institutional structure, partnerships, research and evaluation. Policy implications. This is actually the last slide, yeah? Or I would make this the last slide, right? Think if we look at it with respect to the issues and challenges, right? What you could see that at the system level, it's not just about education, it's really about human capacity building, right? Or the human capacity development, right? And to then be able to examine and to be able to ask ourselves what then is the role of MOOCs, right? Which is very much with respect to the purpose of MOOCs, right? And how that purpose of MOOCs align itself to the vision, right? In terms of human capacity development in the country, right? Not just in the education sector, but across sectors within the economy. The curriculum, I think there are quite a number of you that spoke about this quality assurance, quality audit, right? How do we ensure that? How do we ensure the alignment between teaching learning activities and the outcomes? How do we ensure that assessment is aligned to learning and teaching, right? How do we ensure that we are able to capture the impact of it? That is also about the equal access to quality, like education, learning. So the curriculum itself, we know that the way curriculum are designed might marginalize certain people, right, to be able to engage in it. So are we marginalizing people by gender, race, or religion, right? We need to consider that. Cost effectiveness, external efficiency. Are we aligning the curriculum to 21st century competencies and getting students to be able to manage how to learn? The third one, infrastructure, hardware, and resources. Again, something that we need to constantly consider. So when we are looking at MOOCs policy, I think it's not just education learning type of policy, but there is also a link up to the ICT master plan, right, with regards to infrastructure, resources, as well as hardware. The learner support, again, really crucial. Are we able to provide some sort of a blend, right, to provide certain people who do not have that capacity to learn, right? That is something that we are trying again to do in the MOOCs for the domestic workers. You know, it's like to have a blend. Academic and teaching staff support and professional learning. I think quite a lot of the professional learning does not take place just in case. Just like MOOCs, it takes place just in time and learning by doing. As they are developing the MOOC itself, they are actually learning how to create the MOOCs. So it must be very clear about what then what type of support could be provided to academic and teaching staff in order to do that. The structure and policies. Think when we look at the system level, even if we like look at policies and we look at like grants that are being provided, right? I think the government can do more in order to create more collaboration between universities and between countries, right? So if you are just looking at this room, it's really great that you have signed a MOU, right? That we might see more collaboration across countries, right? But are we able to encourage the international sharing of these different courses, not just in terms of opening up the course, but in the development of the course, or even in the customization of the course, right? Could there be more cross-pollination, right? Across countries, across between universities within the country, right? And of course, the last one is research and evaluation. So the research part, as in, could we start small first in some of the country which are first starting out and using that as a model, like the model university or the model cluster of universities, like very much like what Malaysia have done, right, in terms of just involving a few universities in the beginning. But is the process well documented? I think big question mark. Is there any research that really takes place so that eventually that could be scaled up as a prototype? Big question mark as well. Right, so I would probably leave you with this. This is me. You can contact me in that email address. Okay, this is the younger version of me. Yeah, when I first know Dr. Wang Liping in 2008. All right, yeah. All right, thank you so much. I'm got to apologize for the delay of time, but I would share that responsibility with Professor Im. Yeah, from 3 slides to, you know, it's like 20 slides. What is this, you know? Thank you so much. Yep.